Yeah, let's probably start with introducing the new exercise sheet. That will be quicker. Ah, okay. So I hear Leipzig got a mail this morning too. That is good to know. Yeah, the new exercise sheet you can find on the page, along with some training data you will need. That was this one, focusing mainly on the neural networks chapter and also in part on the decision trees chapter, since we are a bit running over time here with this one. First question is on perceptron learning. So you are, supposed to apply the perceptron algorithm to submission of exercise four. For Weimar, it is not voluntary. This will be the last one that is a requirement for the exam admission. For Leipzig, essentially all exercises are voluntary, right? Okay. Right, you are supposed to apply a perceptron to a Boolean formula, in this case, A and not B. And essentially here your task is to find the parameters for a perceptron by hand. You can do that by following one of the algorithms we've seen, or if you can do it more quickly another way, then that is also fine. That's not clearly defined for this exercise. For Weimar, the latest update is in the mail from this morning that Nadine Glaser sent around. I don't have anything more up to date than that. Yeah. So, as given in the hint here, it might make sense to start by drawing a coordinate system that, in this case, then would have the features xA and xB as their coordinates here on the axis. And you should be rather easily able to answer this question B if you've followed the lectures or read the slides. Then the next question is again on perceptron learning with a somewhat bigger data set with 12 examples in a two-dimensional feature space. And here again, you are supposed to first draw these examples in a coordinate system. If you do this with pen and paper, you can just print this out and use this one, or you can create something in any software you like to use. So just to be clear what is meant here, so the first point here with attributes 1 and 3 would go here, right? And it's a positive example, so let's draw a plus here. And second with 7, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 4 would go here, and it's a negative example, so we'll draw a minus, and so on. And then in the second question, we are supposed to find the straight line that separates these classes. So if there were just these two points, then this line might work just fine. If you, before the full data set, you'll have to see. And then specify its linear equation in this form that we know from the lecture. If you remember, this this form describes the set of points that are exactly on this line. So if I were to write this as a set expression like this, then I would say these are all points x with the property that this w0 plus w1 x1 plus w2 x2 equals 0. And then this, for any point exactly on this line, this holds. And as a hint, if you pick out two particular points in the one I've drawn here, this might be the point 2, 0, and maybe this one here where it intersects the grid as well, and put them into this equation, then you should be able to figure out the W's. And then in the next table, you should evaluate this equation for all the points in the data set and see if you spot a pattern with respect to the other rows. And in the next question, you are given a perceptron, a parameter set for initialization. And then again, investigate what line in our feature space this corresponds to and how this line classifies points. As you know, depending on the particulars of the W values, the line might assign a positive class to points lying on one side and a negative class to points lying on the other side. So that is what you need to figure out for D here. For question E, you should run the perceptron training algorithm by hand with a learning rate of simply one. So that keeps the calculations simpler. And you are asked here to do this for three iterations by hand. So that means if you start from a table like this, you will have to fill in what is y of x, given what is written to the left here. This should be possible to figure out. And then you can also figure out what is delta. This is simply using the same symbols as they are written in the algorithm that we've given on the slides. And then based on these two values, you will be able to say what these three values should be. And then you can repeat the process and so on. So this table has basically in the first 12 rows, it has these values from the data set here. And then there are another 12 rows with these repeated and so on. So, and after doing this for the first three iterations by hand, you are asked to do the rest with the computer. You can write a Python script to do this, a rather simple one, but actually if you would rather use an Excel spreadsheet or something like that, that is also enough. You can just fill in the simple formulas here and copy them, and this should be rather straightforward, but maybe still somewhat instructive. The next question is on decision trees, and we are again talking about Boolean formulas here. And you are supposed to construct decision trees for the given Boolean formulas. And as the hint here says, it might be a good idea to first determine the data set. So for the first one, we have attributes A and B. And as you know, they can be both zero, or one of them can be one, or both of them can be one. And then let's properly write XA and XB here. And then the question what C of X is determined by this formula, right? So this, in this case for question A, it would be zero here and so on. And this means this completely specifies the data set that you are supposed to use. And then you have to construct a decision tree. There is no requirement to use a particular algorithm to do this in this case. So you can just pick some attribute for the first split. And maybe let's say I want to use A for the first split, and then that means I have to figure out what examples are in this node and what are in this node, and then that will determine how I split further, right? So this, if you view the lecture again, if you're still unsure, then this should become clear what you have to do. Exercise 4 is decision trees again, with a data set about dogs being given that you should classify. And here you are asked to apply the ID3 algorithm that we saw in the lecture and use the information gain criterion to determine the attribute for each split. So this will have several steps and will be a bit more complex to complete this exercise. And finally, once you have constructed a decision tree with this procedure, you are supposed to classify this new example determined by the three attributes here. That finishes number 4. Number 5 is on overfitting. In general, but also applied to decision trees now. And there you should think about again how you can define overfitting, what its relationship to inductive bias of a model is. These are things we have touched on over time, so it might make sense to review them if you're still unsure here. And in the last question, we are asked to give three examples of how overfitting can be reduced and inductive bias can be controlled in a machine learning setting. These can be very general ways or ways that are specific to a given classification model. There are essentially many examples that one can think of here. Exercise 6 finally is another programming exercise. Here we will revisit this web page classification task that we have been working on. If you recall, in the previous exercise sheet, we limited ourselves to a simpler problem where we had only a binary decision to make, whether the site was, a site that sells things or not. Here now we extend this to this unrestricted classification setting that we have seen in the lecture on neural networks. I might quickly revisit this here as well. There it is. Towards the beginning, but not exactly at the beginning of the slide, I think is the one I want. Yeah, so this is the setting we are working in now. You are given a data set with a set of features. The data set, by the way, you can also find on the course website here next to the worksheet. This is training data. And each example now has one of K classes. The thing about the data set you are given is that the class is not yet in this form that we have specified here, which is a vector of ones and zeros and K dimensions. Instead, what we give you in this exercise is a vector of, sorry, is a single string for each class attribute that is one of the six classes that we have identified. These were discuss and sell and so on. I guess the full vector is not shown here, but never mind. So that means the first thing you have to do is turn the class in a format like this, and that is also given as a hint for the first question here. Next, you are supposed to implement the incremental gradient descent algorithm for multi-layer perceptrons. We have this algorithm on the slides as well, and also remember that we talked about this last week, I think, in this notebook here that you can find on the slide, where we showed the implementation for the XOR problem, so with only two classes. So you are welcome to use this as a basis and simply extend it to this K class setting here, and that way there isn't too much work to do in this implementation. Something to pay attention to here is that we want the predict method of our model class to again return one of these six possible values as strings. So you have to take this k-dimensional vector representation of the class and turn it back into what the data set gave you. Now, the next task then is to simply run the algorithm based on the way you've implemented and modified it. And then you are asked to compute the misclassification error on the training set using the predict method. So if you read in this data set that you are given into a pandas data frame and simply take the column with the class attribute from that, then you will have a vector of all the true class values of all the 2000 something examples that are in there. And using the predict method from your implementation, you can in the same way generate a vector of all the predicted classes, class values from the model. And given these vectors, it is very straightforward to compute the misclassification rate. And that is what you are asked to do here. And finally, you are supposed to modify the fit method so that it's using batch gradient descent instead of incremental gradient descent. So on the slides, we have given batch gradient descent for linear models, but not for multi-layer perceptrons. However, there are several hints on the slide that are helpful. For example, these two slides here compare the operations of the multi-layer perceptron model working on single example to those working on a batch of examples. And based on this, it should be fairly simple to adapt this implementation to the batch setting as well. Finally, we again have an optional bonus challenge where your task is to take this testing set that you will also find next to the exercise worksheet on the page. In this data set, it has the exact same attributes as the training data, but the true class value is not included here. That figuring that out is your task now. And to do so, you can use everything you have learned so far. There are some hints given here that, that might help you improve the multi-layer model that you have implemented. For example, while in the exercise, we compute only the training error. If you recall that unit, you will remember that this is probably not a good predictor of how well your model will perform on these test values that were not part of your training set. So you might, based on this insight, decide to split up your training data and use part of it as a development set to tweak the parameters of your algorithm. Similarly, there is another hint that tells you that in the setting where we now have k different classes, and in particular where these k classes are not balanced. So if you look at the data set, at the training set, and count how many times each class occurs, you will find that there's one that is most frequent, and then there are some that only occur rather rarely by comparison. And if you think about it a little bit, you will find that in this situation, the misclassification rate itself is not very helpful. So you might look at this library function that is suggested here called classification report. And this gives you a bit more insight with additional metrics about how well your implementation did on each of the individual classes. And finally, you are supposed to again produce a set of predictions in the same way as the last time we did this. And there will be a leaderboard again. Okay, questions on this sheet? So regarding the question in the chat, that depends on whether somebody uploads something, if there will be a solution example. But we will also discuss the solutions for the third exercise sheet after this here. So if there are no questions on... Yes. Whenever I find some in either Moodle, I will copy them to the other one so that everyone can benefit from those.